Hello and welcome to this session on the mental well-being of moms in association with Kaleidoscope. A very good evening, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us today. Kaleidoscope is a mental wellness center led by a team of experienced and certified psychologists who have designed programs, workshops, and counseling sessions to suit the needs of individuals across all age groups. We have with us today Ambika Chawla, a clinical psychologist. Ambika is an RCI licensed clinical psychologist. She has extensive experience in handling clients who have suffered trauma like POCSO, child labor, domestic violence, and trafficking. We also have with us Prachi Kohli, who's a counseling psychologist. And she's also an RCI licensed rehabilitation psychologist and plays a vital role at Kaleidoscope as a counseling psychologist. Her expertise lies in the areas of child and adolescent counseling and career profiling, relationship, and family interventions. Welcome, Prachi. Welcome, Ambika. Thank you for taking the time out and joining us today.
Thank you, Pasna.
So if you all have any questions, viewers, please feel free to add them in the comments and we'll definitely ask them for your advice. So I'm going to get started right away. What exactly, according to you, is mental well-being?
Mental well-being is just like a physical well-being. So whenever we hear the term physical well-being, we mention it as something which is having no disease, like absence of any disease. Similarly, with mental well-being, it's like absence of any psychological de-stress. Apart from that, mental well-being also comprises of that, you know, what is the inner potential of an individual? Is he or she actually aware about their inner potential, about their inner strengths, their abilities? Apart from that, it also comprises of that, you know, how you are able to manage your life challenges effectively and the way you maintain your interpersonal relationship with people. So a lot of psychologists, you know, have studied about mental well-being, and they suggest that there are five vital components of it. One is contentment and happiness. So whenever we talk about contentment and happiness, it means that, you know, you are satisfied with whatever you are and you are feeling happiness from within. Then there is also a positive relationship with people, which means that you are having good interpersonal relationships. Even if you have conflict with anyone, you are able to resolve it and able to move ahead. Then is a mastery of skills. So whenever I'm talking about skills, it doesn't mean that, you know, you have to be a professional who is good with a lot of stuff. It could also be meaning that any skills that you have as an individual and you are able to have a good control over it and you have mastered that skill, be it even a communication from people. Right. Then we have a purpose and meaning of life, that, you know, you have found a purpose and you have a meaning in your life, which doesn't only revolve around being in an office, having goals set. It could also mean that, you know, might be you like something in gardening. So you're practicing that and you have meaning attached to it. So all these things are comprising of a mental well-being. And if an individual is able to handle them effectively, then we say that an individual is having a good mental well-being.
Great. I'm going to remember these points. And go and do a check on myself after I finish this session. What, according to you, is the difference between, like, we've heard a lot of words being thrown around. So what's the difference between depression and anxiety?
Upasana, these days, you know, people are becoming aware about mental health, psychological problems, because we are all stuck in this lockdown from past 1 year. So thankfully, people are becoming aware. But at the same time, we are also using a lot of words, very commonly, out of which one I've heard is depression. Whereas depression and anxiety are both different disorders, and they both also throw a very, very different picture. So you can kind of see them as opposites of each other. So I'll elaborate a little on both of them. That in depression, a person usually experiences a lot of sadness, loss of interest, lack of energy, social withdrawal, negative thinking, overthinking, rumination, has feelings of worthlessness, hopelessness. These are, you know, common symptoms which a person usually experiences or goes through in depression. So there are other emotional changes also that a person can feel. So at the cognitive level also, there can come different changes in the person. So basically in depression, you know, a person usually has a decline in their overall picture, in their overall performance. Whereas in anxiety, now if we talk about anxiety, anxiety is most commonly, you know, experienced in the physiological form. For example, there come changes like restlessness, palpitations, breathlessness, trembling of hands, mouth goes dry, you sweat a lot, there's dizziness, there's chest pain. So these are common symptoms which are usually experienced by people having anxiety, but these are not just only symptoms. You also experience anxiety cognitively, emotionally, behaviorally. So like we saw, you know, in depression, the person's performance declines, and in anxiety, usually the person remains restless, fearful, and uncertain about future, and overthinking is one of the common factors. So that's how you can probably differentiate between depression and anxiety.
Got it. You've really made it very clear for all of us, Ambika. And I appreciate that you're not using too big medical terms so everybody can understand easily. So the pandemic has had many effects on people everywhere. According to you, what are the factors moms face, like lack of time, that will affect mental health?
So basically, you know, as a Pasna, you also mentioned it very rightly that pandemic has created a lot of issues in our life. And as a psychologist, you know, we are hearing each and every day that a lot of people are suffering because of the pandemic. One aspect of it is obviously the physical issues that people are facing in their day-to-day lives. Apart from that, a lot of mental health issues are also rising up because of this pandemic. And after, you know, working with people since a very long time, I feel that hardest of the hits amongst this pandemic is the mothers. Because reason being is that, you know, they have to manage a lot of things together. And one of the major point of this is that, you know, they have to maintain their work and life equally. So basically, even if you are a professional, you know, you are a working mother, then obviously you have to give equal amount of time to your office the way you give it at your home. Even if you're not working and you know, you're just you are a homemaker, then also I feel that you have a lot of burden upon themselves. So work and life are two major components through which mothers are obviously at you know, are dealing. Apart from that, there is division of labor. So in India, you know, we say that we have moved forward a lot, but still I feel that still we have that kind of thought process. We are still living in that patriarchy society wherein people say that, you know, women will only do a lot of household works, men will not support. Even if a lot of men do these days, but still there is a lot of thought process till now. So division of labor is another important thing. So a child is crying and the mother is cooking in the kitchen. So she is handling all the two things together. So again, I feel division as a labor is another important component that mothers are dealing with these days. And then is caregiving. So the sole caregiver of a child is the mother. Bachcha ro raha hai, so the mother has to take care. Bachcha padhai kar raha hai, so the mother has to take care. So caregiving.
Maa ko hi deta hai.
So, you know, even as a child, you know, kuch bhi problem hoga, mamma, meri English ki book nahi mil rahi hai. So, mamma ke paas jayega. Bachcha kabhi papa ke paas hai, kisi aur ke paas nahi jayega. So, these are very important factors, which I feel that are actually overburdening mothers a lot. And then because now the husband is also at home. And you are also at home. So another important is interpersonal relationship with the family, with the couple. So a lot of times, you know, the couples are actually, you know, having that thought process that what is our relationship? Because they are spending time with each other. So what their relationship is all about. So I feel these are the major things which mothers are dealing with these days because of this pandemic. And because we consider them as superhumans, as super beings. So again, that thing is that, you know, we have to keep everything intact. And we have to be healthy. We have to maintain our professional life, our personal life together.
Okay. I have Deepti Khanna online. And she says, Deepti, it's similar to what we already answered, actually. Okay. She says, how as a mother can I cope with the stress going on with the pandemic, which reflects that the children are also getting affected?
So Ambika, would you like to take this question?
Yeah. So Deepthi, we will be elaborating on this question slightly later in the session, but I would still like to answer this. So the lockdown, you know, has brought a lot of mental and physical pressure on all of us. I would say, you know, we all also have to slow down a little bit and kind of take out time for ourselves also in the middle of all the things that we are handling, all the household tasks and everything. So I would simply suggest over here that look at your schedule, timetable it if possible, give yourself some time of the day, spend some quality time with your children, with other family members. So kind of, you know, rejuvenate yourself, take out some quality things or hobbies which help you in re-energizing. So these would be some quick tips that I can give you right now. We would definitely be elaborating on this.
Yes, Deepthi. Stay tuned. We have a lot of similar questions which we will address for sure. So as you both know, moms are multitaskers and always juggle many roles. So how can moms cope, especially with this overburdening during COVID, during the pandemic?
Yeah, you know, moms, they are like, superheroes in our lives. They have an equivalent role, you know. Anything like Prachi said, mamma ye ka hai, mamma wo ka hai. We just, probably we can ask her tomorrow, that like, mamma chand ka hai, ya sitare ka hai, wo bhi la do. So, they do struggle a lot. They have a lot of responsibilities. And with lockdowns, which are random, which are unwanted, which are uninformed, when they come with a lot of responsibilities and it does not take a permission from anyone, you know, before burdening them with those responsibilities. So they are the responsibilities are given automatically, or they are assumed that suddenly jab lockdown ho jata hai, you can't go out, to achha, mamma hi sab kuch karengi ghar mein. So mothers are the common victims that we see. So as mothers, obviously have to take care of any number of things, their work, household, kids, everything in the home. So there seems no way out of this vicious circle of roles, responsibilities, work. But what can you do to help yourself in this excessive burden? Because it's also not possible for you to not do work or say completely no. But we can help ourselves manage and adjust with this overburdening, I would say. So out of which first one, a few suggestions that I can make over here is keep having short breaks. So in the day, don't, keep the task in sequence for yourself, like one after the other, because that is going to drain a lot of energy out of you. And so keep having short breaks of 15 minutes, half an hour, whatever is convenient to you. Rejuvenate yourself in that. Take power naps possibly. Another one would be pre-plan your day. And make everyone in the home aware about it, that, I have the schedule. So kindly, if you have anything extra, so that they can also make adjustments as per your schedule. Another one would be give time to yourself and practice some of the self-care tips and techniques. So we know a few of the things to say, it helps us to feel happy, to get back to energy. So try and practice those things. Accept help of others. Sometimes it is difficult for mothers to take help of others because they also want to do everything. But it is not a sign of failure, I must say that. So take help of others. Divide and delegate the responsibilities. If it is possible, you see that this is a simpler task. This can be done by somebody else. So try to divide it and delegate it to someone else. Spend quality time with your family members. Now, lockdown can either be taken as a problem, or it can also be taken as a bliss. So try to spend some quality time with your family members and manage your time efficiently. So we do have limited number of hours, but I believe if we can manage them efficiently, then we'll be able to take out time productively.
Thank you so much, Ambika. Simran, I see your question, and Reema, I see your question. I will just come to it shortly. These are members who've logged on, so I just want to make sure that they know I'm seeing the questions. another question I have is physical exhaustion, constantly feeling tired and lack of sleep, fatigue. These are all words used very often by moms. How do we learn to combat the same?
Yeah. So we just talked about overburdening ourselves. So obviously, you know, while managing these multiple roles, a person ties herself, a mother ties herself in these numerous duties, responsibilities to be carried out the whole day, and that too adequately. It's also not possible for mother, you know, to just finish the task only for the sake of finishing it. So they have to also complete it adequately. So the person needs to remain in these boundaries, you know, and also carry out multiple roles. So these responsibilities will start to become a burden, and when you're overloaded with work inflow, it leads to exhaustion. Now, exhaustion can be in two ways, either physical or mental. So physically, you can see some of the changes in your body that, you know, changes in sleep or appetite. This is one of the very important change that comes into your, in your body, that you're physically do a lot of tasks in the whole day. So you're not able to also sleep at night. Yes, it is possible. And your appetite also gets reduced. There is tiredness. There are body pains which are unexplainable. There are headaches. There's nausea. There is changes in bowel movements and digestion. So these are different changes which are experienced by different persons when they get physically exhausted. So over here, my suggestions would be how to combat them specifically is to practice downtime. Downtime is basically, you know, practicing deep breathing exercise, relaxation, meditation, yoga, whatever is convenient to you, you can just simply pick it up and practice. Try to release negative energies through physical activity. So, you know, as we grow in the age, our physical activity reduces. But there is required, you know, a particular amount of physical activity to still be practiced in each and every age. So as per your age, try to include it back into your routine. Take small breaks and eat healthy. Eat healthy is very important because you're having physical burnout. So possibly your body is not giving a balance to the amount of energy you're taking out.
So I actually have Reema online and she says, kindly guide. I have been a support emotionally and mentally to my friends, aging parents, but now I'm not able to take it. And I feel my goodness is not being taken in the right sense, which is internally triggering my anger. So what would you advise to her?
Okay. Sorry, I didn't get the name.
Reema.
Okay. So, Reema, I would like to, first of all, you know, give applause to you for carrying out such an important role over here. And you should also appreciate yourself for carrying out such an important responsibility. And secondly, and very importantly, I would like to tell you and give you a reminder that we have limitations to certain roles. Whatever roles we have in our life, as a daughter, as a mother, as a wife, we have certain limitations. So after that point, we cannot really do anything in anyone else's life. So that's a reminder to ourselves that whatever far I could have gone, I have done that much. And thirdly, with respect to anger, the point of anger you have brought in, so I would suggest a few anger management techniques over here. You can probably try and practice them and see if they help you out. So anger usually brings in different signs in ourselves. So like, for example, your ears go red, you start grinding your teeth, maybe you start getting a headache. So these are certain signs that anger shows in us before getting angry, that we do not, you know, snap out suddenly. So try and figure out these signs. Find out and identify the triggers of your anger. There are common triggers that usually bring the anger out. I would suggest that if you know that, yes, there is a good amount of anger lying inside you, then use it up in some productive activities, maybe some physical activity or something else that you like to do. People also take out their anger in creative activities like drawing mandalas. Then there are some other situational techniques which can be practiced, like counting backwards, having a glass of water, avoiding the situation, taking timeouts.
Great. Thank you so much. Viewers, thank you for logging in. I see a couple of medical questions, but Ambika and Prachi are not medical doctors, so we won't be able to take those questions. But anything concerning mental well-being, please feel free to ask, and we'll definitely take those questions. The things about COVID, supplements post-COVID and things like that, we will not be able to answer, but the rest we will definitely go ahead and try to give you a satisfactory answer. So both of you, Prachi and Ambika both, being physically together at home for such a long time can be very challenging. Can moms spin it in a positive direction and utilize it to bond with their children instead? What are your thoughts on this?
So basically, you know, since past 1 year, you know, we are hearing news about COVID, about pandemic and the lockdown. So, you know, it has created a lot of negativity around this term. But as you, we all say that, you know, every coin has two sides of it. So it's very important for us to also see the positive angle that, you know, COVID has brought into our lives, wherein, you know, we all are at homes and we all are spending good quality time with our children, with our families. So schools are operating from homes, offices are operating from homes. So now it's a time wherein you can bond with your child. So the few tips which I would like to give as a psychologist to the parents, you know, that how they can actually deal and, you know, spend good time with their children are, first and the foremost is creating intentional interactions. So when I'm saying intentional interactions, it means that, you know, you actually have to go and spend time with your child. So generally, you know, a lot of parents come and say ki ye to apne kamre mein hi baithe rehte hain. They just lock their room and they sit, they are either on laptops or on phones. So it's very important for you to actually go and talk to your child. Now, I'm not saying go and peep into their lives. That will again create that resentment from the children that, you know, our parents are doubting on us. They are not creating that trust on us. So rather than peeping into their lives or on their cell phones or whatever they are doing, you know, you can just go and talk to them that, you know, how's your day or how's your school going? Do you want any help from us? So these kind of questions will actually help you to have an interaction with your child. So first and the foremost thing that you can do is to create interactions. Then is making family time. So it's very important that, you know, we as a family sit together. So now what is happening is that you are busy with your schedule, your child is busy with your schedule. So it's very important to have that quality time of your family. So probably one thing that we can do is on a dining table or when you are having food together. So try that, you know, whenever you're having a food together, you are not on your WhatsApp or you are not watching television. What you're doing is to actually sitting together, having a meal together and discussing about what was good, what was bad in the day, what you actually want to change in this day. So you can also do that. Then is taking your adventure outside. So this is probably something that can be done by the parents who have very, you know, younger children, is that, you know, you can create something at a home itself. So what you can do is that, you know, there is an obstacle run. So what you can do is to create some obstacles and then your child, and you can tell your child to run in that particular platform. So it will also help your child to have a rejuvenation, and your child will actually be happy that, you know, the parents are encouraging him or her to play. Because at the end, play is one of the most important components of a child's life, and we cannot take this out of their daily routine. So you can create something which is recreational for your child as well as a good bonding time between you and your child. Then also similarly, so now what is happening is that we all are at homes. So the child is also busy and, you know, is missing going outside. So what is child doing is ki ab usko yaad aa rahi hai that, you know, we used to go out with friends, we used to have coffees, we used to have dinners, going to school, the major thing. So hum school ko hamesha ek educational institution se samajhte the, but I feel school is more like a developmental institution. तो बच्चा सोशली भी इंटरेक्ट कर रहा है, बच्चा कॉग्निटिवली भी सबसे मिल रहा है, यू नो, सो ओवरऑल डेवलपमेंट होता है. तो उसी तरह हम घर पे भी ऐसा कुछ कर सकते हैं. सो प्रोबेबली फन थिंग यू कैन डू इज, यू नो, यू कैन क्रिएट समथिंग लाइक टूडे वी आर गोइंग टू हैव अ डिनर इन अ रेस्टोरेंट. सो यू कैन गिव अ फैंसी रेस्टोरेंट नेम्स, मामास किचन फॉर एग्जाम्पल, एंड यू कैन क्रिएट अ स्मॉल मेन्यू कार्ड. And anything which your child likes, so now you can tell your child, okay, now this is the restaurant and you are here. So that creating a you know, restaurant kind of a feel at home itself. Or if your child likes to, you know, go to adventure park, so I'm not telling you to create an adventure park, but still, you know, maybe you can have something wherein a child can have fun or have some games, interesting games. So do these kind of things, because isse aapke bachcha aap ye feel karega that, you know, parents are actually understanding what I'm going through. So rather than just focusing on that you have to study, you have to sleep, you have to eat, usse kya ho raha hai, bacche ko lag raha hai ki school mein pehle teacher bolti thi, ab mummy papa ghar pe bol rahe hain, to usse uske liye kuch difference nahi hai. Now what we have to do is to make this as a quality time, we need to make a child understand that yes, I am understanding that you are missing all these things, and as a parent I would give my best to provide you with all these things. So we can do such small activities to bond with our child, which will also help you to improve your relationship with them in this long.
Great. Thank you so much, Prachi. Those are some really helpful tips. My next question is, hormonal imbalances. We have them at every stage of life. So do you also think that hormonal imbalances present at different stages can also impact a mom's well-being? How and what can one do to combat the same?
Upasana, thank you so much for bringing this topic up. When we think of mental well-being, it's a far away thought topic or concept. But thank you so much for bringing hormonal imbalances. Well, we all know that, you know, emotions are dependent on neurochemicals and hormones. So if I feel happy, it's dependent on the hormones. And if I feel sad, that is also dependent. So they help us in experiencing the emotions that I feel. And women do have an extra, cup of emotions. And we tend to experience the changes during the hormonal makeup at different stages of our lives. So even, while being on the menstrual cycle, we PMS, while giving birth, or during the whole period of pregnancy. And at the end, when we are also facing the menopause. So these are different stages in which, you know, commonly the women or mothers, they experience such kind of changes. So young mothers go through massive amount of changes, which also includes postpartum depression. We must know that. And menopause phase also have its own bittersweet experiences. So because these experiences are involuntary in nature, we do not have any control over them. They tend to bring emotional changes, like, you know, sudden mood swings, like crying spells, feeling guilty or feeling embarrassed. Now, this particular inability to have control over these emotions or these feelings, it may bring helplessness. And it further leads to certain psychological changes like anger, like sadness. Why is it happening to me? Why others are moving around so normally? Why am I having these mood swings so much? So I may also have aggression. So at this point of time, I would say that because this is a natural process, your body will go through it. So one must give herself a break and let the body heal. Heal through this natural phases of life. So one must make herself aware, how to deal with these particular situations, is that you can make yourself aware that what all changes can you go through? Right. Why are these changes coming in? What hormonal imbalance or what extra hormones are released in my body? So that you know what is triggering what. And by knowing yourself much better, it will definitely help you in dealing with this change or the phase much better. So this awareness will basically help you in coping better.
Thank you so much, Ambika. Thank you for addressing that question. Tell me, what are the signs we should look out for that indicate mental health is getting affected?
So basically, when we are talking about the term mental health, so basically it's like that, you know, first we need to understand that our brain is the controlling unit of our body. Whatever we are feeling, whatever we are thinking is the way our body generally reacts. So the symptoms or the signs that whenever, you know, our mental health is deteriorating, so it is in a multifaceted way. So probably physical symptoms are also there. So physical symptoms like, you know, you have headaches, like Ambik also mentioned earlier that, you know, you have headaches, you have body aches in general, and your appetite changes, your digestion changes, all these things physically, your body is now telling that, you know, I'm not feeling good. It's not something that is to be taken casual. One needs to, you know, start actually understanding that now my body is in a need of help. So what happens when we know, whenever we have a fever, our temperature goes up and suddenly we start taking medication. Similarly, takes place in the case of our mind. So few symptoms we need to be more mindful about. So the ones that I've already mentioned are the physical one. Apart from that, we also have emotional symptoms. So particularly an individual starts feeling angry, frustrated, even if there is a, you know, very peculiar thing that just took place, might be your child just broke a glass. So probably now you have started feeling agitated because of it. Or you are seeing that, you know, your husband is not taking care of the home in a proper manner, the way you actually want. And you have started feeling angry. So anger ho gaya, agitation, frustration. And sometimes we all generally face this and, you know, we overcry. We are generally, even a small thing happens and we start crying. Crying spells. So all these things are, again, the emotional response of your mind that you are not feeling good. Apart from that, there are also another behavioral issues that start coming up, wherein you have excessive change in your appetite. Either you are not at all eating or you are overly eating. So both of them are an adverse sign. Apart from that, there is also nervousness. So probably a lot of, you know, people start snail biting whenever they are feeling nervous. Or there is also, you know, avoidance of the responsibility. So particularly there are a few things that you are doing earlier with a lot of interest, but now you don't want to do it. Or even if those responsibilities are coming to you, are actually avoiding those responsibilities in your day-to-day behavior. So avoidance of responsibilities is another thing. And then one of the most important symptoms is that now you have started overtaking of alcohol or other substances is also there. So all these things are the little signs and symptoms which, you know, one should be highly alerted upon, that if any of one or two are coming together. So now it's a sign by your mind that it needs to be rejuvenated. It needs to be actually, you know, taken care of. So jaise physically hota hai, signs and symptoms aate hain, usi tarah, even when your mental health is deteriorating, certain signs and symptoms are being shown by your body.
Got it. Thank you so much, Prachi, for that. Tell me, how do you talk to someone who has been diagnosed with depression and anxiety? What are the do's and don'ts that one should be, you know, mindful about?
Yeah, Upasana, so this is another sensitive topic because a lot of people are also going through depression these days, and the lockdown has made them aware about that condition. So, that is something which is involuntary. First of all, we all need to know that. Just like our physical health, I mean, nobody is inviting COVID-19 at this point of time. Nobody invites cancer. Nobody invites heart diseases. Similarly, we do not invite any form of psychological disorder also. Depression, anxiety, anything. So if they are all involuntary, they may be affecting person's behavior, which is why people think that you're just acting it. But we all need to know that it's involuntary. So based on that only, I have certain do's and don'ts. Persons around that particular person needs to be patient. So you have to be patient with the person who's dealing with these problems, because it's going to take time. It is not going to be an easy process. Feel empathy. Now, I get it that you don't have those problems, but at least you can try and understand the pain of the other person. Practice I statements instead of you statements. So instead of saying you are doing this, you are doing that, instead of that, you can probably say, I have noticed this. I see that you are doing that. So in that way, you know, a little perspective is changed of the other person. Get to know about the symptoms and the condition. So the family members, we should be knowing what the problem is and how else can it change the picture. Let them know that you are there. Let the person know who's affected by the illness that you are there, so that whenever they want, they wish, they can reach out to you. Listen to their needs of support. Ask them where do they want that support. It is possible that they want it only emotionally, not physically, but you're present physically and not emotionally. So at that point in time, you're not helping them. So listen to where do they need your support and communicate. So communicate between each other as much as you do. There'll be less misunderstandings. These are certain do's. You cannot fix it. There are professionals, there are health experts who are there to help them out. So you cannot fix them. So the moment you get to know, try and go and take professional help. Do not give up. Like I said, it's not an easy process, so don't give up on the person. Don't be aggressive for certain things which they are not doing according to you. Don't force them for alcohol or other drugs because they don't help. They even take you more down. Do not try to medicate yourself. Sometimes we see that, okay, my friend took all of these medications. Let's try that out. So don't try to do that. Constantly talking about the problem is a big no. So if you keep on talking about that, the person will also keep on going more and more in it. Don't pressurize them for doing something that they can't. Don't ask them to come out because it's involuntary according to you. It's not possible for them to do that. Don't keep comparing them with their previous image. You were like that a few days back. You didn't do this like that. Why have you become like this now? So don't compare it because it's not in their hands anymore. Be there, support them.
Thank you so much, Ambika. That's really, it's a real eye-opener because sometimes as friends, we hesitate. What should we do? What shouldn't we do?
Right.
So I recently read an article on the New York Times, which used the word languishing. And it said that people say we still had energy. It wasn't depression. We didn't feel hopeless. We just felt somewhat joyless and aimless. It turns out there's a name for that, languishing. Languishing is a sense of stagnation and emptiness. It feels as though you're muddling through your days, looking at your life through a foggy windshield, and it might be the dominant emotion of 2021. What would you say to this, and what are your tips on how to deal with this feeling? Because I know I've felt it. It's that word just puts everything in perspective. Prachi, I think we've lost Ambika's connection.
Yes.
I think she'll come back. So what would you say in your, experience, that what would be tips on how to deal with 2021?
So firstly, one thing which 2021, I would say since 2020, we all have been learning is that, we have to take care of our mental health the way we used to take care of our physical health. So it's very important for all of us to be on that same platter that, we need to, the way we are taking physical health as a very important component, similarly, we need to take mental health. So right. One and the foremost thing which I feel we all should do is to, journal our thoughts, our emotions. So what happens is that since a very long time, we all are suppressing down, whatever we are feeling, we are suppressing down, be it with that thought that, what society would be thinking about it, or what, this happens with everyone, just generalizing our thoughts. Ye toh sabke saath hota hai, humare saath bhi ho raha hai, koi nahi. But now I feel that since 2020, learned the biggest lesson to actually understand that what we are going through, what are our thoughts, what are our emotions. So through this one activity that, every time in the night, just take 10 minutes of your time and actually journal your thoughts. Ki how was the entire day, how you actually felt. And if, for example, you felt angry, so what at the moment you actually did.
Correct.
So probably now this will actually help you to get in touch with your own self, to get in touch with your thoughts, with your feelings, as well as with your emotions. That's very important that, which I feel we should be doing. Apart from that, we all are, in this notion that we are overburdening ourselves. So yeah, so now with overburning, we have actually doing a lot of things which are not even expected out of us, but just because we have to do it, we are doing it. So another thing which I feel that, you know, we should actually learn the art of not saying, of saying no, like, you know, I cannot do it. Probably asking someone else for a help, or by you know, telling someone else, ki aise nahi, I cannot do this. Probably you can take help from other people around. So these two things which I feel that should be done foremost in year 2021.
Thank you, Prachi. Ambika, anything you'd like to add? Tips on how to deal with, you know, 2021 and this emotion called languishing.
Yes, definitely, Upasana. So firstly, I would like to ask you that how much did you relate with this article and this particular
I
period?
Really related to it because it was, I have no enthusiasm left to do anything. Last year, it was still, you know, there was some, like, you know, I love to cook. So there was some josh that, okay, let's do this. Let's make this. This year, I'm like, no.
Rightly said, you know, this change, a lot of people have told me also that last lockdown, we were also excited. Okay, we kind of took it as a vacation. We prepared a lot of different food items, which we all were seeing on status and everywhere. But this lockdown has, you know, brought in completely some other different picture. And we are able to relate it with ourselves, I mean, very easily, because this picture or this feeling is something which cannot be, you know, said no to. So it is very common for us all to see a foggy future, foggy things. I mean, it is, I would say that these two words, foggy windshield, is very, very appropriate right now, because the future seems so uncertain. So I would say, you know, that right now the only key would be have positive thinking and experience positive emotions. So like Prachi said, that intentionally talk to your kids. So similarly, we also need to intentionally involve into having positive thinking. Because we are all filled with negative news, negative thinking right now. We definitely need to involve ourselves intentionally into positive thinking and experience positive emotions. We have to stop blaming ourselves for things which are out of control, because we all are also getting many bad news these days. So there are certain things which are out of our control. So let's stop blaming ourselves for that. Develop coping skills. This is the time where we are dealing with many multiple challenges, so we have to develop coping skills and practice thought journaling. So it is sometimes difficult for us to, you know, understand what all is going on inside of me. So let's try to write it down. Let's journal all of our thoughts. That's all from my side.
Thank you, Ambika. Thank you so much. Self-care. It's something moms practice very little of, especially when during the pandemic time is so short. Please share with us tips for effective self-care.
So thank you so much, Upasana, for bringing this thing. So first and the foremost thing, which actually I would like to address to all the moms over here, is that, you know, taking a little time for yourself is not bad. So what happens is that we feel ki, oh my God, bhai, I'm taking time for myself. I am not, you know, is time pe shayad main apne bacche ke liye ye kar sakti thi, ya ye main apne bacche ko ye de sakti thi. So that is something that is, you know, so much at their head that they actually forget to spend good time with themselves. So please, my first thing, which I actually want to tell to all the moms, that, you know, don't ever and ever think that you are doing something wrong by taking care of yourself. It is your need. It is like a body fuel. Jaise jab car mein petrol ya diesel khatam ho jata hai, car nahi chalti. उसी तरह अगर आप अपने साथ टाइम स्पेंड नहीं करेंगे, सो प्रोबेबली यू विल आल्सो नॉट बी एबल टू, यू नो, वर्क वेरी एफिशिएंटली द वे यू यूज्ड टू वर्क अर्लियर. सो फ्यू टिप्स टू नाउ टेकिंग केयर ऑफ योरसेल्फ. सो दीज आर बेसिकली सम थिंग्स व्हिच यू कैन डू इवन सिटिंग एट होम. You know, first and the foremost is take enough opportunities to laugh. So whenever we are laughing, we are, you know, actually producing positive hormones in our body, which is very good for our health, for ourselves. So take any opportunity to laugh, or probably, you know, you can watch anything that you like, which actually makes you feel happy, or you actually laugh at it. Then is second is taking enough sleep. Now what happens is that especially when we have toddlers at our home, we are not able to sleep. However, it is very important for you to sleep, because at that point of time, you're actually, your brain is also resting, and it's very important for your brain also to take rest. So please, it's very important for you to take efficient amount of sleep in the day. Then exercise and keep your body moving. So probably now what is happening is that because of the lockdown, we are not going out. So probably a lot of times we used to go out to park, to walk, you know, we used to travel to our office. So we were moving. Now what is happening is that we are majorly at a standstill. Although you're doing a lot of activities, but do something through which, you know, your exercise. So probably you can have a 20 minutes of a yoga session at your own home. That will help your body, blood circulation will improve, and eventually you will also start moving and feeling better. Then is creating a no list. It's very important for you to actually say no. So probably that, you know, because we have that concept that moms are always at home. At work, they cannot say no to their children, no to their families. But it's very important for you to realize that you are not a robot. You are also a human being who gets tired, who needs refreshment, who needs love. So it's important for you to say also no whenever might be any request from a child comes.
One, Prachi. I really like this idea. I'm going to do it today. Create a no list. I love it.
Then, you know, be kind to yourself. If you are not able to help your child, or if you are not able to help your partner, it's okay. You know, probably there would be times when they will not also be able to help you. So it's okay. Be kind to your own self. Be kind to your emotions, to your thoughts. Then it's very important to pursue it, what you actually love the most. So I would actually want to know this answer from moms, that, you know, aapne kab last time wo cheez kari thi jo aapko bahut pasand hai. Something jo aapke dil se nikalta hai. Probably sketching or cooking or gardening. Abhi, you know, a lot of moms say we love cooking, but why do you love cooking? Because, you know, you have to make your child eat healthy food, nice food, so that they are able to have a proper meal. So it's very important to actually take time out for yourself. In that time, you can do anything that you love. Probably you like to sit in a balcony having a cup of tea or a coffee. Do that, or read your favorite novel. Do anything that you love. So it's important to take care of yourselves, to be, you know, getting in touch with yourself, so that you are able to spread happiness across everyone in your life.
Thank you, Prachi. That's really lovely. Thank you so much. Tell me, Prachi and Ambika, what are the healthy practices that one, I know we've heard this all before several times, but what are the few healthy practices that we must adopt during this time? Like, what are the must-dos for a healthy mind and to stay?
Okay. So, yes, in these rough and tough times, we lose touch with ourselves, and we are running in the race of competition, perfection, multiple roles. So we neglect ourselves, you know, and these neglection, they bring in negative effects on our mental health in the long run. So it is appropriate to act in the right direction and for a healthy mind. And the baseline is basically, you know, I would say to release negative emotions with time. Keep releasing negative emotions, keep releasing negative energy from within to heal. And also to allow positivity to take a shelter within you. Right. Now, a few suggestions from my side would be maintain an activity schedule, you know, wherein there would be a few star marks, that these are certain things which I have to follow to keep myself positive and healthy. Manage your time wisely. We have limited time, so manage it wisely. Spend quality time wherever possible instead of quantity time. So, you know, we keep maybe sitting with our family members, but eventually, are we talking something? Are we spending some good times with each other? Are we making a memory? To spend some quality time practice some form of hobbies. Like Prachi said, that we need to bring back those things, those activities, those interesting creatives that we like to do, we like to follow. Try something new, be creative, be innovative. I don't think anybody is stopping you, so go for it. Being a mom doesn't mean that you have to, you know, forget yourself. And lastly, I would say love and embrace yourself for who you are. You're doing a great job. So love yourself and be appreciative of yourself.
Great. Thank you so much, Ambika. And for a healthy mind, Prachi, anything you'd like to add to that?
Yeah.
Any must-dos?
Yeah. So first and the foremost, which I've actually talked about a lot of times, is that, you know, firstly, get in touch with yourself. It's very important. Being a mom, mom doesn't mean that, you know, you are just forgetting your own self. Just remember, might be, you know, from your spinster time, that, you know, what you used to love the most about yourself. Probably do something that about that, or, you know, get in touch with your emotions by either writing. Now, getting in touch with your emotion doesn't mean that, you know, you have to cry or you have to sit in a way and journal your thoughts or write something. That could also be that, like for, you know, me, sketching would work. So if I'm sketching, so it will help me to get in touch with my own self, that what I'm actually thinking. Then don't suppress your emotions. If you actually feel that, you know, something, someone has died, which is actually hurting you, so go and talk to that person. Now, I'm not saying go and just put allegations on that person that, you know, you did something wrong. Just communicate with them effectively so that your relationship is also not spoiled with that person and you are still able to communicate what you actually wanted to say. Right. Then self-care, as I earlier said, I gave few suggestions about that, you know, how self-care should be. That's very important. Then I think Ambika have also mentioned about that, you know, maintain an activity schedule. So the entire day should be scheduled. So, you know that at what time you're waking up, at what time you're actually doing, you know, sitting with your children. So probably this will help you to bond much more with your family because you all are on the same platter. It is not happening that probably you are having an official meeting going on and your children are free. So probably you can maintain yourself and, you know, you can bond together. And then, yes, take this time to actually love yourself because I feel before the pandemic, we used to say, ghar pe baithne ka time hi nahi milta hai. Now, it is a time that, you know, you all are at your homes. I know that, you know, professional commitments, personal commitments are there. Now, take this time to strengthen your bonds with your family, to actually, you know, be with them and to actually be with your own self. Because it's important. Jab tak aap khud ka dhyan nahi rakhenge, tab tak aap dusron ka dhyan nahi rakh sakte.
Absolutely correct. There's a phrase that I really love that says, you can never pour from an empty cup. You have to ensure that your cup is full, at least half full in this case, if not anything else. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us today. Thank you so much, Prachi and Ambika. And my thanks to Kaleidoscope and to Nitisha and team for coordinating this one. We have a talk by Sister Shivani on Monday, and she's a fabulous speaker, so don't miss that. Stay tuned to the Gurgaon Moms Facebook page and you will find the details there. We also have a session on mental health of children with Dr. Amit Sen, which is on May 24th at 11 a.m. Again, the details will be there on the Gurgaon Moms Facebook page. We have a lot of fun and informative articles on our Gurgaon Moms website. So do check that out and you'll find details over there. And do stay safe, stay home, take care, and stay happy, everybody. Thank you so very much for joining us today.
Thank you, Apasna, for giving us this opportunity. It was really good interacting with you and your team.
Thank you so much, Prachi. Thank you.
Thank you for having us over, Apasna. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.